I like the microphone says Pastor on it. That makes it easy. It is a pleasure to be here with you today, and I wasn't expecting the invitation, but it was very gracious. I appreciate that so much. The family and Pastor Lowe and all the family and ministry and elders here, greet you in the loving name of Jesus. I am from Columbus, Ohio, and I'm just going to try to get you out of here as soon as I can, but can we let the Spirit of the Lord move a little bit in here today, if that's all right? Amen. Thought I'd take a minute and just kind of tell you a little bit about myself, since many of you don't know who I am, and we'll get through that first time meeting and won't hold back on me too much. My name is David Wedland from Columbus, Ohio, third generational Pentecostal ministry. My father started Christ International North Apostolic at the time, over 50 years ago. And my father passed away 15 years ago. I just lost my mother 3.5 months ago in the month of June. I laid her to rest. But I've been involved in music, was touring ever since about the age of 14. Had a heart transplant towards worship in my early 20s. Used to always just want to tour and play and just be a really good musician and do all that kind of stuff. And there was a life-changing moment. I always knew I had a call on my life for pastoral ministry and for other things as well. And I remember the time when I finally had that contract offer to go to Nashville and start doing stuff I always wanted to do. And it was between making that choice to do that and do what God had called me to do. It was very hard and natural. You know what I mean? You work so hard to achieve something. But I really knew what God wanted me to do. And I said all that to say this, that my heart is worship. I remember back in the day, my father was really into worship. They used to call him Latter-rain, scatterbrain, charismatic, all kinds of crazy stuff. And worship is a very powerful, powerful thing that God has blessed us with. And so what we're going to do here is, if it's all right with you, I'm going to teach a little bit on worship, but I'm going to preach. I definitely have something that the Lord has laid upon my heart to share with you in the name of the Lord. And I don't know if you have Bibles or not. The technology spoils us, doesn't it? First scripture I'm going to read, let's all turn to the book of Acts, the second chapter. We had a wonderful time last night. Pastor Hollis, we had him in our church about 6 weeks ago. We had a fellowship meeting up there, and he did a terrific job. We had just an unbelievable time in service. And again, I want to thank the ministering leaders here for opening up the church doors for the ACN. I want to encourage all to come out. We have a super regional coming up in the middle of October, and it should be just a very powerful time. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And if you could stand with me, the reading of the word, I'm old school like that. Acts chapter 2, in the 42nd verse. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. One more scripture I care to read, and it's found in the book of Zechariah, the 14th chapter. Zechariah, the 14th chapter, and we'll be reading the 16th verse and the 17th verse. Zechariah chapter 14, verse 16 and 17. And it shall come to pass that every one that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. And it shall be that those who will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. Those that refuse to go up to Jerusalem at the appointed time, there will be no rain. Father, we thank you for your Spirit and your anointing. We pray, Lord, that this word will impact our hearts and change us and transform us into the image of Jesus Christ. I ask you to bless this church and this congregation and its leadership in the name of Jesus. Everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Thank you. I want to talk about a few things that maybe spurn some thought. I don't know if you've ever heard it. I want to talk about what worship is when worship is not. I've been fortunate enough to travel, and I've seen about all of it, being a musician and traveling with bands and all over kinds of churches all over the country and all over the world. I've seen every expression. I've seen everything. I loved one of the churches I went to was a Jamaican church in Miami. I'll tell you, those folk, that was really, really cool. And like some Jamaican praise and real radical. It was a lot of fun. And I've seen it all kinds of expressions. There's been a transformation of worship and music over the last 20 to 25 years. A lot of it has been very good. Some has not. And I want to talk about, in a sense, because we get people sometimes, we get rooted up into music. Music becomes a very powerful instrument in the church, but it also becomes a point of conflict. People have styles. They have things they like. They have things they prefer. The reality is that we don't worship a style. We worship a God. And because of that, he is way beyond any style or form or any such thing. But God, oftentimes when there's a need in the church, back in the days, there used to be a lot of songs that talked about me. I used to always get a thrill out of people when we sing. When we all get to heaven, everybody would shout. But when we sing anything that was vertical, anything that spoke to God in adoration, everybody would sit. A lot of times we respond to when we think we're going to get something from God, but we don't respond when we're going to give something to the Lord. So there was this transformation beginning to take place, and music began to transform itself. One of the problems is we identify worship with music. We identify worship with styles. We identify worship with singing. Worship is not that. Worship is not the lifting up of the hands. Worship is not clapping. It is not jumping up and down. It is not shouting or any of those kinds of things. I'm going to come down here with you guys, but that's all right. It's not any of those kinds of things. The Bible tells us, Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it talks about, to me, this is one of the fundamental scriptures to express what worship really is. Worship is our lifestyle. Worship is our heart commitment to God. And so there's differences between what worship is and what the expressions of worship are. Expressions of worship are lifting of the hands. And I talked a little bit theologically why we should lift our hands. Worship expressions are when we dance for joy, as we were dancing earlier, jumping up and down. Those are all expressions of worship. But worship is a heart commitment to God. Worship is not related to a place. Worship is related to the heart. Oftentimes people come to church and they will sing on Sunday, but they do nothing Monday through Saturday. Worship has nothing to do about locations, has nothing to do about places. Worship is what you do throughout the course of the week. Every time you fall on your face and pray, you're worshiping. Every time you come to church to Bible study or Sunday and open up your Bible and respond to the word, that's worship. Every time you come and you come to church and you vacuum the floors or you clean or you teach Sunday school, that's worship. Every time you're in a praise team rehearsal and participating, that's worship. Every single time you go out and mention Jesus Christ to someone and testify to them about it, that's worshiping. You're worshiping the Lord. So we worship and should worship on a daily basis to a commitment level to our Lord Jesus Christ. And as our commitment level and devotion increases, our worship time will increase. You can always tell people, though, that usually don't spend a lot of time in devotion to the Lord through the course of the week, because they usually come to church and don't have the ability to express themselves. Because oftentimes, there's a communication in the spirit, and our spirit gets lit up, and we respond to the presence of the Lord. I always tell young people, you know, if LeBron James can walk into the door, your favorite athlete, most young people would stand up and say, oh man, that's so cool. They would respond appropriately to the presence of the Lord. If you're used to spending time in the presence of the Lord, you recognize it and you respond to it. And that's where the expression comes in. We lift our hands because we're responding to the presence of the Lord. We jump up and down because we're responding to the presence of the Lord. And so oftentimes in old school Pentecost, they taught us, many of them did, that we don't worship or dance or shout unless we feel something. And so we don't want to do it outside of the Spirit. But the Bible tells us and commands us to praise Him. The Bible says to praise ye the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise Him on the high-sounding cymbals. Praise you the Lord. That praise you the Lord in Psalms 150 is actually hallelujah, which is a command to praise the Lord. Look at somebody say hallelujah next to you. You just commanded them to praise the name of the Lord is what you did. Hallelujah is a command to praise Him. Amen? And so we need to realize that worship is our commitment level. And I talk a lot with praise teams and musicians that lead people in worship. It is not about singing. It's not about songs. It's not about perfection. It is about your daily commitment to the Lord. It's about your devotional life and then coming up and lead people into the realm of the worship life. Experience a deeper level of worship in our commitment. There's something about the corporate worship. How many loves to worship corporately with the body of Christ? I love it. I can spend time by myself, but there's something about spending time and worshiping with the body of Jesus Christ. It takes us to another level with the Lord. And God has been, though over the course of the 20, 25, 30 years, however long it's been, He has been cultivating the ground for a deeper level of worship and intimacy within the church. That's why we've seen a lot of the transformation, that praise has become more vertical. It's talking to God. It's talking about Him. It's giving Him glory. It is learning to respond to the presence of the Lord. Not so much me worship. It is God worship. And some of the old songs, nothing wrong with that. Please don't get me wrong. We still need to sing them. But I'm saying there is a deeper level of intimacy with God that God is trying to bring the church into. Amen. God is really trying to get our heart to connect with the Lord in a much deeper level. How many is excited about that? I'm excited about that. In John chapter 4, an interesting thing happens. He talks to the woman at the well, and he talks to her about worship, which is an awesome thing because her life certainly wasn't straightened out. And for those that think you have to have your life completely straightened out to be called to worship, every person here has been called to worship the Lord, has been called to be a devoted person. I have a young ministry tell me, what do I need to do? You need to respond to the call to prayer, and you respond to the call of worship. Those are the two calls you need to respond to, and if you do that, God will work the rest out for you. And those are the two highest calls of the church, so the call to prayer and the call to worship. And if we do those two things, great things will happen. And the Lord came along and called this lady to a realm of worship, and He says to her, you know, I am He that's here. And she says, well, I've heard of you guys worship in the mountain, and we worship over here. And see, she got caught up, and a lot of people get caught up that worship became a place. Until you got to a certain place, you couldn't worship. And oftentimes people think, I go to church to worship. We should have already been worshiping on Monday through Saturday. Amen? But He says to her, He says, they must worship in spirit and truth, and the Father seeketh such to worship Him. Let me tell you what the difference between praise and worship is. Praise is our effort to get to God. Praise is something that everybody can do. Praise is something that the trees do. Praise is something that the birds do. I just got from Panama City Beach a few months ago, and I loved going out and seeing the glory of the ocean and the sunset and just amazed at the splendor of God's creation. If that don't make you want to lift your hands, I don't know what wouldn't do it. You understand? But yet, began to tell her that the Father seeketh such to worship Him. Worship is when God finds us. It's when He connects with us. Is when His Spirit touches our hearts, it ignites a flame inside of us. Praise is us saying, I need you, I need to get to you. And oftentimes we clap our hands and lift our hands, has more to do with praise than it has to do with worship. It's worship when God finds you. For the Father seeketh such to worship Him. How many desires to seek after the Lord here today? But I desire even more to come in contact with God. And worship is when the Lord touches my life. It's when He finds me. It's when He begins to sing melodies in me. I love Ephesians 5:19 and Colossians 3:16, singing in our hearts and melodies to the Lord, psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. When the Spirit begins to sing through our hearts, when the Spirit begins the motivating factor for our voices and for our hands lifted high and for our commitment, the Spirit contacts with our spirit and begins to bring us into another realm. And God is trying to bring the church into a much deeper level of intimacy. But we can't do it without the Spirit of God. We can't go deeper without Him. We can't find Him by ourselves. It's respond to the Father to us. So the Father is looking for worshipers. That's why Jesus went out of His way to find her, to tell her, not only can you be who you are, but you can be transformed and you can become a worshiper of the living God, not just here, but anywhere. And God is looking for worshipers. And how many wants to be found by the Spirit of the Lord?
The Lord looks at you and he's delighted with your worship and with your expression. That's what I want. And that's what we need in the church. We don't need another program like was talked about last night. We don't need another get together. We need a deeper level of the anointing and presence of the Lord. What good would the church be without the presence of God? We would just be an empty building going through motions of nothingness. But with the presence of the Lord deeper, I believe we'll begin to see a transformation that's been taking place. God is loosening a generation to understand worship as it ought to be understood. I believe that with all my heart. He's loosening a generation to understand worship as it ought to be understood. We need worship. Look at somebody say, we need worship. We need to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. I remember preaching a place one time, and I was preaching revival, and the Spirit of God was unbelievably powerful. Just unbelievable service. The next day, I preached somewhere else, and it was as dead as could be. Nothing was happening. There was no response. No one seemed to care. And I went to the Lord in prayer. I said, Lord, I don't understand why this is. At one place you'll go, and I can see your spirit moving generously among your people. I go somewhere else, and your spirit seems to not be moving at all. I don't understand that. I mean, it's not like they were sitting and listening. They looked like they wanted to go to sleep. And the Lord began to speak to me. He said, because there was a disconnect between the pulpit and the pews. The congregation had not prepared themselves for the word. It doesn't matter how anointed the man of God is. If the congregation does not worship the Lord, then there's no connection between the pulpit and the pew. The Spirit of God connects. It flows through our lives like rivers of living water. And as we prepare ourselves through the course of the week, as we open up our Bibles and read the scriptures, as we fall on our knees and pray unto the Lord, we prepare ourselves. And to me, there's a heavenly connection that begins to take place. Worship becomes into the environment. Worship is a result of God's presence coming into the environment. Worship is a result of God leading the direction and the flow of the worship life of the congregation. Worship enables the ministry to preach with more anointing and more effect because there's a connection that's flowing through the building. Are you hearing me? And God wants to flow through this building like a circuit. Anyone that has electricity, know if you break one circuit, the flow stops right there and everything shuts down. It used to be the old Christmas trees. If you had one bulb that was out, all the bulbs were out. It's the same thing in the church. We have to have a circuit of the anointing to flow through the congregation. You play a powerful role in what happens in your congregation. It's just not your pastors, but it's your pastors and you laboring together throughout the course of the week. And when you pray, it has as much impact as when your pastor prays. It can set the atmosphere for somebody to be delivered in the congregation or somebody to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It can set the atmosphere for somebody to be transformed and delivered from drugs and alcohol and brought out of a life of disaster. You have the ability through your worship experience to bring a transformation power as the Lord comes in and said, I've been looking for an atmosphere of worshipers, of somebody that's connecting with me on a spiritual level. Not somebody just going through the motions of praise, but the motions of worship, that what our lip service is saying, our activities are duplicating. If we say we love the Lord, how many loves the Lord here today? Do you love him enough to call upon his name on Monday morning? Do you love him enough to open up your Bible and read about his greatness and his goodness? Do you love him enough to come into the congregation and abandon everything that's on you and say, I come and abandon my heart to you, Lord. Take me, saturate me with your presence. Use me for your glory. I love you enough, Lord, that my mouth service will duplicate my heart service. He says, I'm looking for worshipers, and I will find you. A lot of times we use the expression, say, I found God. No, he finds us. None of us are saved because of our own accord. You have made a choice, but no man comes to the Father except the Spirit draws him. And the day you came to the altar and repented of your sins was the day the Spirit of the Lord drew you to the altar. It created an atmosphere for you to make your heart right with God. Isn't that awesome? Because God is always active in our hearts. He's always active in our hearts. There's a scripture in Proverbs. It says, the rain falls according to the vapor thereof. The rain falls according to the vapor thereof. The church is unique. The church is unique is that we can't, in the natural sense, provide an irrigation system. I want to compare Egypt to Israel. Egypt was flat desert area. It didn't get much rain. It was dry. And the farmers at that time basically had to create pumps to irrigate their crops. They would run lines to the River Nile, and they would take them out to their areas, and they would literally, with a foot pump, they would pump water in saturated area, then move it in saturated area, move it. They had to work hard to irrigate their crops. It was a disaster. But when the children of Israel got to the land of Canaan, the Lord said, there will be rain. I will provide the former rain and the latter rain. It's made up of hills and valleys and mountains. It would be very difficult to irrigate it any other way than through rain. In other words, if there was no rain, there was no harvest. And they required rain, and so the church. If there is no rain, there is no harvest. We need rain to produce a harvest, and it's the Lord that provides the rain. And the scriptures teaches us that the rain falls according to the vapor thereof. You know, just like you could tell, I'm an ex-roofer, and I love the job sometimes. I hate it other times. And I can always tell, I don't care what the meteorologist said, I can always tell by looking at the sky and feeling the humidity that, boys, it's probably a good idea to make sure this roof is covered. I know it's blue as blue can be, but I have a feeling here in a little bit we're going to see more than blue skies, if you know what I mean. I could tell by what was rising into the atmosphere. And the more that rises into the atmosphere, the more disruptive the atmosphere becomes. And the more rain begins to fall and saturate the ground. The church needs rain. And it needs heavenly rain. We become dry. Now listen. This is what happens. If rain is not present, oftentimes we will go back to doing what we used to do to provide a source of water. We'll go back to the styles of Egypt and try to work our way into some type of environment of saturation. When the reality, the only way we'll ever receive the saturation that comes from heaven is when worshipers arise and begin to ascend up into the atmosphere of the vapors. The Lord said there in Zechariah that during the Feast of Tabernacles, when it's time for the families to come up to Jerusalem, to the house of God to worship, if they did not come to worship, then there would be no rain on their crops and their harvest would die. And I would suggest the reason why we are seeing a drought in America spiritually, even though God does have a church, spotless church, a remnant that I believe is present, and many are here today. Hear me right now. The reason is there's not enough rain in the atmosphere, and we need revival, and we need an awakening like was preached last night, and we need a saturation of the rain. We are losing a generation to hell's fire, and we need to be about our Father's business. And what we need today is fervent worshipers that will touch the throne of heaven and send something into the atmosphere that will cause a response from the Lord. Just sitting and doing nothing will accomplish nothing. But worshiping the Lord from our heart will produce a revival in the last day. I remember my church, we love to worship, and I remember a time, it was one of those worship services, and we went through the service, and service ended about 10. It was a Sunday evening service. And we continued to worship. I remember people singing songs in tongues, spiritual songs. I wish I had time to go into that. I just sing songs under the influence of the Spirit. It went on to about 12:30. 1 a.m. Just unbelievable event. And I walked out, and they had some food out in the fellowship area. And my wife come and tap me on the shoulder and said, "Dave, come on out here." I said, "What?" She said, just come on, just come back in the sanctuary." Now, mind you, it's after 1 a.m. I come walking in there, and she goes, "See," and I just began to weep, just began to cry. And the Lord spoke to me, and this is what he said: "Where did you go? I came into this atmosphere to commune with you, and you walked out of my presence." And it just sounds like a ridiculous thing. Most people, it's late, you got to go to work, you need to go home, but the Spirit of the Lord is calling out to a people to worship. He so desires to hear the sincerity of your heart, and he will respond with rain. We will see a generation of young people. We will see families restored. We will see the supernatural occurrence when the worshipers begin to arise and worship from the depths of their heart. God convicted me that night, and he showed me something about his desire. His desire. I'm going to ask everyone to bow your head for a moment. I didn't want to take too long today. Check your heart. Check your heart. I was at a big conference. I put together this big praise celebration event. It was a huge deal. Just had a lot of people to work with, and it's a very, very powerful thing. And we went through, and let me say this to everyone. Music can be great, but music is not worship. We need great worship, not great music. Now, musician, I want great music. But I would any day trade great worship over great music. We don't even need music to worship right now. I walked off the platform I was leading when I actually had a voice. I stepped off, and the leadership looked and said, "You know, we got to go." I don't know what to do with this, I'm telling you. The Spirit of the Lord fell down so powerfully. There was around 500 people present that the whole building, except for a few, was laying on their face before God. It was an unbelievable outpour of his Spirit. When we make church, make worship the centerpiece, we say, "What about the word?" See, you need to understand worship again. Worship is inclusive to preaching and teaching the word of the Lord and receiving it. So I could be preaching, but if you're not receiving it, you're not worshiping. You have to receive it. When it becomes the centerpiece of our activity, we will see everything that God has declared for us. How many wants that? I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet with me. I'm no Randy Hollis. I'm no Bishop Smith. I'm no Pastor Lowe. I'm not my father. But I'm a man that loves to worship the Lord and have desired to see the congregation of God overwhelmed with the presence of the Lord. I had a dream one night. I walked into this church. The church was huge. It was just, I couldn't see the ends of people. And they were singing a song, "Worthy is a Lamb, worthy is a Lamb, worthy is a Lamb."
over and over again. The whole congregation had their hands raised up, and the present glory of God was so powerful. And I've seen where God wants to take the church. And it's exciting. Let me talk to every husband, father here, and mother and wife. How many wants to see the presence of God so thick in your home? What you feel at church is in your house. So let's lift our hands to heaven right now and let's worship the Lord for a little bit. I was in prayer in here last night and I felt the release. Just engage the presence of the Lord with worship. The heart of worship. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Open up your mouth. If you love God, open up your mouth and talk to Him. Father, we praise you. God created your mouth to worship. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Is there anyone in here that hears the call to worship? If you hear the call to worship, I'm going to ask you to come to the front with me. If you hear the call to worship, I'm going to ask you to come to the front with me. And I do not want to stand up here and sound like I'm the authority of worship, but I hear the call to worship. I hear the call to worship. Father, in the name of Jesus, if you hear the call to worship, I'm going to ask you to come up to them. Come on, y'all. Lift up your hands and begin to talk to the Lord. Father, we worship you today. We honor you, God. God, give us a deeper desire, a deeper heart, Lord. A deeper passion for your presence, Lord. We need more of you. We need more of you, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Open up your hearts. We ask heaven to open up. God is asking for us to open up our heart. We ask for heaven to open up, and God is asking for us to open up our heart. Open up your hearts to the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. Come on, worshipers. Come on, worshipers. Come on, worshipers. Get into the flow of worship. Come on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Open up your heart. Don't hold back. We ask God to pour blessings out upon us. We ask God to pour His promises out. We ask God to deliver us. We can respond to His presence. We can pour out like water. We need to be like the alabaster box and pour out and be broken and pour out in the presence of the Lord. Pour your heart out unto the Lord. Father, I love you. I need you. I desire you more than anything in my life. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Open up my heart, oh Lord. Jesus. There's some of you here that want to break out. This is your moment to break out. This is your moment for that awakening. This is your moment right now. Break out. Sister, break out in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, lift up your voices. Worship Him according to the desire and measure of your hunger. Worship Him according to the measure of your thirst. How many's thirsty for the presence of the Lord? How many's thirsty for the presence of the Lord? Then praise Him and worship Him according to the measure of your thirst. We thirst for you, O Lord. We hunger for you, O Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, lift up those hands all over the congregation. We're going to push a little harder, Father, in the name of Jesus. We pray for a breakthrough of worship, Lord. All over America, let there be a breakthrough of worship. All over the United States of America, let the anointing, let the rain begin to fall upon our generation. Restore our families back together again, O Lord. Restore our children back to you, O Lord. Give us a deeper hunger and desire for you, O Lord. Call us to the level of devotion that would be required, Lord. Send rain upon us, O Lord. Let the vapor begin to rise up from this place. Let the vapor begin to rise up in this place. And send rain down according to the measure of vapor that is sent up into the heavenly atmosphere. Come on, praisers. Come on, worshipers. Not time to be quiet. It's time to lift up a mighty voice unto the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lift up that voice unto the Lord. Come on, give a shout of praise unto God. Give a shout of praise unto the Lord. Come on, I'm not hearing you. Give a shout of praise unto the Lord. Lift up a mighty sound as of a rushing mighty wind. Make your own sound. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Why do we shout? We shout because we are trying to duplicate the sound that heaven is trying to produce. And there's a sound of shouting in the heavenly atmosphere that wants to be echoed in this atmosphere here on earth. Lord, help us to hear the sounds that are echoing from heaven and produce those sounds in our earth today, Lord. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we shout with a voice They're responding to the sound that we hear in the heavenly realm, oh God. Break through the heavens, oh Lord. Let rain come down from heaven unto earth, oh Lord. Save our young people, Jesus, and set them on fire with the baptism of your Spirit. Set our elderly back dancing again, oh God. Renew their faith and their strength. Heal broken bodies and broken hearts in the name of Jesus. Pull them off the streets, oh Lord. Come to the altar with a true repentant heart, oh Lord. We need you. We desire you. We love you. We want you, oh God. Come into our presence, oh Lord. Help us to respond right to you, oh God. Somebody join with me right now. I'm hungry for a move of God. I'm hungry for a move of God that transcends just having good church. I'm ready for a revival of the rain that falls from heaven. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain, declared the prophet. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, praise him up here. Praise him up here. Praise him up here. Praise him up here.